this workshop. Over to you.
So good afternoon all. Thank you for this warm welcome, Dr. Meghna. And we will start this session now. On behalf of the entire Ankur team, I welcome you for this webinar on HPTLC and applications. And what I understand is most of you are undergraduate students. So I will be focusing this presentation to learn something basics, and then we'll move on into the specialization and see more about what HPTLC is and how different analyses are done using that. It's always been an enthusiasm for us to interact with young research minds who have a lot of potential, who can really go and innovate and do many of the things. Like from your organization's history, it has been linked to many of the innovations which are coming up. And these innovative minds, it is our privilege to be a part of you and to explain you about this concept so that you can use it for your boundless activities of research. So with this note, let me start today's session and I'll start sharing my screen. What we are going to talk about today is about HPTLC, the technique and applications. So let me start this presentation. I have worked already, have known my introduction, and this session will last around an hour's time. And post that, we'll be also entertaining and answering the questions which are of your interest. And more questions also welcome at our email IDs. I'll flash it at the end of this presentation, where you can write down your queries to us and we'll be happy to help you out with those. So let's start today's session. We are Ankrome. So let me introduce firstly our company and our organization. And we have been really long into this, around 40 years, four decades, we have been into this HPTLC. And ever since, the technique is growing and changing with times and meeting the requirements of analysis which are there into the market. And so is the job done online also. We have our presence on most of the popular platforms of YouTube, Facebook, and LinkedIn. And YouTube, we have our dedicated channels where you can have a lovely listening to a session of HPTLC analysis by the software. This is exclusively designed for the Zoom webinars, as we know. Hello? Yeah. This is exclusively designed on the platform for Zoom, where you can observe it under your mobiles. And so the fonts and all have been taken care of. We give a free training to students, government, personals, and many others. And we have been training since. And now we had this count of 4,000. But now by this year, we have been able to contact to research minds like you over 13,000 and still counting. So I think so by this time we have almost reached 20,000 mark of scientists who have interacted on this platform. And I'll all consider all and each individual a scientist, because we are into this platform and we are hearing this to increase our knowledge. So that gives us a good contact history, and really we understand what is going on and what is required. You can write us your feedbacks and all your requirements at hpdlc@ankrome.in. This is our lab from where I'm live and showing you this presentation. We have an experience team with all analysts from different fields, most of all our postgraduates. And we have a lot of work which we have been doing, and some of this have been shorted out. Publications have changed by due course, and also is the instrumentation to cater to the requirements of the latest guidelines, especially the 21 CFR. We'll all understand those and understand the HPTLC in brief. This is our video YouTube channel, which I wanted to show. Now let's come to the core topic for which we are here today. First, understand thin layer chromatography, although it's a way difference, but the separation happens by thin layer chromatography. That is the basic principle. I would like to say it's the principle, but it is not the technique. So I will tell that principle is the same thing. You have your stationary phase where you apply your spot This is done traditionally by capillaries, and then you separate it with a chemical composition known as the mobile phase, which is a binary or tertiary gradient, that is mixture of 1, 2, 3, or 4, or 5 chemicals together, and you develop them onto a plate, separating each and every component. This started very old when Michael Svet, he started accidentally explored the separation of the plant pigment. And I'm sure that during your course, you must be doing this with a piece of a chalk, where you just pot it and you let some water or something just pass through it, and you see the spots are getting separated. You can simply take your pen nib and just dab a spot onto the chalk, and then you let it into this mobile phase, which is a solvent, and let it go through. So what happens is the components get separated. So this happens by the same phenomenon, and that is done on flat thin layer plates which are there. You have silica, and then you spot the sample and you run it with the mobile phase, you get the components separated. And this is the core principle what happens. Now in HPTLC, this has changed quite a bit. And from 1960s, the start of the instrumentation in HPTLC or thin layer chromatography started. And slowly from TLC, it became HPTLC. In the due course of time, there were other competitors, and because of which TLC was not practiced that popularly. But owing to the simplicity, low cost consumption, and the effectiveness, it still retained its position. And today in this era, we have not only TLC, but a better form of TLC, which has turned and changed the whole concept of TLC and became HPTLC, that is high performance thin layer chromatography. Now, typically, if you see a TLC, as I showed you in the earlier picture, you have a chamber where you spot these things and you separate them. This is what you get from a TLC separation. Let me show you what HPTLC gives you. So HPTLC example, as you can see, is far more comprehensive. You get to understand a lot much more details with a very precise resolution. Separation to in distances of millimeters, which gives you better understanding of what the sample has, and when you compare this, and all this at 1/4 of the cost. So unlike any other chromatographic techniques like column chromatography, where you have HPLCs and all, this becomes really cheap to handle with minimum knowledge requirement and maximum output which you get. So that becomes a huge advantage. You don't have any preparation time. You just take a plate fresh from the box and ready to start your analysis. So such kinds of things are not there in any other part of chromatography, which you can see popular chromatographies like HPLCs and GC, where you require the detector to get saturated, stabilize the baseline, ensure that there is no carryover which is coming from your your columns or your GC columns. So these all complexities are gone, and that is why this becomes your ultimate tool for your analysis. Whenever you're going for unknown samples, you see that it has a very high matrix. Now, when I talk in terms of matrix, this has got a very high tolerating matrix capability. That is, if you have an oily sample, you still are not worried, because you know with the help of mobile phases, your all components will be at the bottom and your interesting components will be coming out of it. And that is why you are not afraid that I will damage the plate, because ultimately the plate is disposable in nature. You screen it once, get your info, and then you can discard the plate, take a fresh plate, and things can this be happened. Also, you can use the plate if you are not dermatized, but that is just limited to 1 or 2 times. But this is what is about HPTLC giving you next generation chromatography. Now, in terms of what we achieve is miniaturization, which requires less solvents for development. You know, in these days, greener, the more greener, we always talk of greener life. You have electronic vehicles coming in by to save the earth and to save the atmosphere in which we are living. And with this greener technology, the solvent consumption is very minimal, around 30 ml for a plate of to screen 20 samples. That is the biggest advantage. And unlike any other chromatography, you cannot screen so many samples in this unit time. and also the time is required is very less, because you require to prepare the columns and things like that, which is not there in any other system. So this becomes really advantageous, and more number of samples. And similarly, if I talk about more samples, I'll show you another example where we can increase our throughput by 5 times, and that gives you same 20 samples in 5 different steps and gives you around 100 samples per hour, so or hour and a half. So you can imagine the output which you are getting from these instruments and the technique itself. Now, when I talk about TLC, it started with very rudimentary. As you know that we are a subsidiary of, that is, we, our principals are CAMAG, and we are a CAMAG distributor by nature. What started earlier in CAMAG was a very rudimentary system where you had typical dot matrix printers and the big box computers which you were there. You used to feed the commands with a DOS-based command system, and with that it used to scan the plate and give you the results in the form of a crooked lines known as the chromatograms. And even if you have seen these days the ECG machine, it used to be something like that, where you used to get those chromatograms onto the printer, dot matrix printers, and used to be happy with it. But as the technology advanced, so came with the next generation, and we have now the modern HPTLC system, which is very much automated, and it is totally taken care by the beautiful software, which actually helps you documentation and many other aspects. So when you do TLC, you have to write it down in a piece of a paper. I took this much ml of mobile phase, I took this plate, I spotted over here. Such things are gone away. You have a sophisticated instrument software which records all these parameters, and what you need to do is just run this software, which will control your instruments also. So that is how easier it becomes, which is all the instruments are regulated by this software. And then later, or the latest generation of instruments are total contactless application, touch, contactless touch, I would say, entire process of HPTLC. So you, the plate will be automatically taken in, it will do the application, it will do the next step, and without you involving into it at any point of time, just give the command with the samples and mobile phase, and that's it, you are done. So this kind of automation has come up, and this is how the instrumentation has grown over the past years. If you see the very basic TLC kit, it is good for your rudimentary analysis, but it is non-GLP. And you can see that there is no regulation. Any person can do it any way. So basically in HPTLC, you have 5 different steps, which are very critical. I'll come back to it in a matter of a second. But these steps were all very, 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 very manual. And that is why what happens is you have no control over them, and how much is being loaded onto the stationary phase, that is your plate, and what is getting separated, you are really not sure about it. So then in 1980s, you had this semi-automated system where slowly the instrumentation was there, but without any software, it used to be done at standalone. So for example, first part, if I want to do, I have to do it manually. Second part I have to manually operate it, the instrument from outside, and give it a command. So such things were there. It was not computer integrated. And until 2000, where the integrated system platform started with the first phase, and now with the two USP guidelines in the process of HPTLC, we have a standardized software which takes care of these guidelines and also instrumentation control. So this is how HPTLC has changed over the past time. TLC and HPTLC are way different. If you feel that you are just changing the name and doing it, it's not like that. There is a huge difference between TLC and HPTLC, and that is what I have highlighted in this slide. Basically, both are planar chromatography, but in HPTLC, you focus on reproducibility, separation power, high standardized methodology. So you can expect all the work that is done from an HPLC to be done on a system of HPTLC. And that is why you can rely on the results. These are totally standardized format of analysis. So this is a small comparison shown to you. Moving ahead, as I told you, some of the advantages of using this system is in the stationary phase, you can just throw off after you are done. So there is no lack of, no fear of contamination of the system. And as I was telling you, if you see the earlier slide, especially this one, there are different modules which are doing different tasks in the format of HPTLC. And so when I talk about output that I was talking about, I can work on the first instrument. At the same time, my colleague can work on the second and third instrument. My other colleague can work on the second instrument, and my fourth colleague can work on the fourth instrument and fifth, and so forth. So six persons, if you can see from this, can simultaneously work on different stages of their analysis, and that is how within a short time span of an hour, five people to six people are using the same set of instrument, generating the data and giving you the output. So you can imagine how much output you are generating from such kind of analysis. Now, going back, it is also the simplest and fastest. You really don't require, if you have done at certain point of time PLC with a little bit of training on the software and proper methodology, you can start working on HPTLC. It's no big deal. And the low cost, running cost and maintenance is also important, because when you are as a student, you have to worry about the cost incurring which you are there, so that you don't have to worry, because any person can handle it. So that is why even it has a low cost of running and maintenance. And finally, when you talk in terms of output, which you are getting from this analysis is visible and print. We slowly see this as we go ahead, because we need to understand the outputs of this technique in order to understand these points and also the large feedback. In short, the large feedback point I can explain you is, I want you to plot a graph. And for example, if you have a graph and you have 3 points, three data points, from these three data points, you'll be plotting a graph and you will get a curve. But at the same time, if I get to plot another graph with not three but 5 points, my prediction or the graph is much more accurate. So this is how specifically this large feedbacks help you. The more number of data points, the more better is your understanding of the sample and standard, and a lot of information you can get out of it. So this is how the entire HPTLC system is present. Now, when we talk about HPTLC system and practice, for me, how am I supposed to do HPTLC? And the answer is, first, sample preparation. Yeah, just a second. Okay, sample preparation, where you first take your sample, you dilute it into a solvent. This may be done with the help of sonication, or you do a reflux, although the USP does not recommend any long stages of procedures, because at the end of the day, you are developing a method to identify quality check or doing something like that. And if I prepare a very tedious method, 48 hours or 50 hours of succinate, it does not serve me the purpose, because if I am a manufacturer and I am using the same method to generate something, and it will take me 2 to 3 days to get the output, and then only I can start proceeding with my batch. So that becomes very not an acceptable thing. So that generally sample preparation should be simple, fast and adequate for your testing. So you have to define the end point that tells you what kind of a extraction you would require it to be done. And once you have dissolved the sample into a solute, that is your liquid form, you can analyze it with the help of the sample application. That is the first step. We have a manual to automated systems for application. In application, what we do is, we have a stationary phase, that is a plate. I can show it over here. Let me show you. So if you can see the video, which also I'm showing in, this is a stationary phase. This is a glass backing material, and you have the stationary phase onto the top. And what you do is, you can either apply bands like this, then you can apply as the format of spots, or you can do a preparative, that is a huge band, and separate them to get the most out of it for the separation. So these are some of the application patterns which our applicators support, that is in a spray format and all. And then you have the chromatographic development step, that is, you take this same plate, you dip it in a mobile phase, and you separate it, the components. This is again from manual to automated systems. The automated systems take care that you do not change the atmosphere in which this is done, like the temperature or humidity control, which is very much required. So in different kinds of humidity, you will get some variation. And to regulate this, we have a dedicated chamber for humidity control. You know, I suppose everybody of you knows what is humidity. That is the percent of moisture in the air. And that really is a very important factor. So with the development devices, you take care of this. And after that, what you do is, in development, I will take this plate, I will place it in the chamber. The components will be separated. And from the separated components, I can infer from that. And then later on, we have the visualization. Like, we take this plate, we take a UV chamber or a UV cabinet, and in that I visualize it, that is, I observe it. But our goal is just not to observe it, but also record the image of this plate. So we have dedicated instruments to record this kind of image, which is in very low light, because you know that once I keep this plate in a dark condition, you will not be able to see the any of the spots. So our instrumentation is designed in such a way that you can take very low light photography of the plate, and you can store this. And then following by that, you can do is scanning of the plate. Like, you take this plate, we have a dedicated scanner, and that is also a very big data intense instrument, where you generate the chromatograms over here. As unlike any other chromatographic technique, you get to know what is the chromatogram. I'll show you an example of that. And you can take a spectra, which can help you identify what that substance is. And these things are possible with the scanner. We have other hyphenations like the TLC-MS device also, from which you can use mass spectrometry as a detector and extract and send it to the mass. And after that, you can do is a derivatization step. Suppose this spot is not visible to me, I will spray a compound onto this and allow it to heat so that there is a chemical reaction which goes on, and slowly you are able to see what is there onto the plate. So that becomes your kind of derivatization. And followed by that, again after derivatization, you can scan this photo. So that is all possible with HPTLC, and this is how we go about the process of HPTLC. Now, these are some of the advantages of when you should go about for an HPTLC analysis, and some of the technical part. I'll not go into details of this. Regulatory is important, and you have some regulatory guidelines also for this technique, like any other technique. And these are some of the guidelines which I would like to highlight. The chapter 621, which tells you that you can use it for qualitative and quantitative analysis. Now, qualitative is just something like screening, like you just see it and okay, it is present. But quantitative is when I want to know, okay, it is there, but how much it is there. That is my approach of quantitative, and that is achieved from scanning. And then we have identification of fixed oils, synthesis of herbals, and many other topics are covered in this guidelines, which specifically define you that how you should go about for analysis using the instrumentation. Again, this is the hardware part. I'll not go into details, but this is how your data from an HPTLC would look like. And several parameters have been tested when you are doing an HPTLC analysis, like the pattern, how the plate should be, how many spots you have to apply, whether it should be a spot or it should be a band length, the humidity, the development distance, everything has been documented. Instruments are here, you get the output, what I was talking about. So as you see, this is a stationary phase, which you have seen. And from that, we develop it. We get a data, which is then being captured by a visualizer. So this is an application device where we apply the samples onto the plate. Then we have the development device where the separation happens. Then we have a visualizer, which is responsible for observing the images from the plate, and that is documenting these images. because this plate you have to throw it after a certain part point of time. So this documentation remains as long as your data is there with you, and that is an output from the visualizer. Then you have the scanner where you have the chromatograms that are being generated. So these spots are converted into the format of these bands as peaks, as you can see. And then further you can do is go for the MS identification. If you want to specifically know what is this peak, you can take this selective spot and send it to MAS, and you will get the data like this. And after MAS also, if you wish to also derivatize, you can do this plate before the MAS analysis is done. And that plate will be dipped into a solution, a chemical solution, which will give you a derivatized image. So this is being all taken with this VisionCAD software, which is the heart of the entire system that controls and documents the entire process. So then you have the next generation also, HPTLC Pro, which is fully automated. I will just show you a glimpse of how it happens. Let's see over here. So this is the next generation of chromatogram, where there are several modules performing several tasks, but automatically there is no human involvement into it. These are the modules which are performing different tasks, but they are totally interconnected, and the entire process is done automatically. This is the Pro system. Now, the software, when you talk about, there are certain guidelines which we have to pass in order to be okayed for use, and that is the 21 CFR Part 11 compliance, which is there for electronic instruments, and this instrument passes all these criteria: the IQ, OQ, and PQ, instrument qualification, operational qualification, and performance qualification. These three parts are very important in the case of instrumentation, and you can read about those to know more. But our instruments are compatible for all these things, and we do provide IQ, OQ, and PQ data. And these are some of the 21 CFR guidelines. You can just have a glance, and backup tools are there. Like, you have your phone where you take up your backup regularly. Similar is the case of this, where we take a regularly automated backup, which is at the background saving the data. So whenever you lose your, anything happens to your computer, you can still have the data safe with you. So this is how it is there. This is generally how an HPTLC sample preparation is done. You have your crude powder that is converted with a solvent into a such liquid part. And generally you will be having a lot of sediments into this after you sonicate it for 15 minutes and centrifuge. After that, you will get a clean solution like this, of which you can take a little bit, pour into this append off, and use it for your analysis. Okay, so so this is how the sample preparation is being done, and internet work. Okay, and then you have the sample application that is done with the help of instrumentation, which I showed you. This is the semi-automated one, and then you have the fully automated one, and the pro generation, which is there. And some of the things are shown over here, like sample, how many samples and things like that, all work on compressed air, and we normally spray for the application. It is never a contact, so that does not, if you do it manually, what you will do is you will take a capillary and you will load the sample, and what will happen, the silica will get disturbed, which you don't want. So that takes place exactly with the spray-on technique, where the molecule or samples are sprayed onto the plate, and from that, once you have dried it, you can develop them with a mobile phase. So this is how a spray-on technique, after the spray has been done, this is being developed, and after development, you have these separations which you can see over here, and you can see any solvent which you use, it will give you a separation, same kind of a separation on HPTLC. This is because of the spray-on technique and non-contact application. Now this is a plate dimension, how it looks, the 20 by 10. This is the x-axis and this is the y-axis. And then you have the plate size, which is x into y-axis, and then you have the distance from the bottom, the band length, and the 15 tracks, all are well documented into it. Next, you have the plate image, as you can see. The SST over here and the sample and standard being simultaneously applied. So you will have your sample over here, you develop them, you will have a standard, you will develop here, and then from this comparison you can identify whether this substance is actually present in your this substance and identify from that. So this is the plate layout. Now the next process is development. This stationary phase is taken, and now we go for the next step of development, and this development happens in our instruments, which are fully automated over here, as well as you have the manual systems over here. Now it is a specialized type of chamber known as the twin trap, because the chamber is like this. If you see from the side, there is a small hump over here, and this is how a TLC chamber with a known as twin trap is seen. Here you have to keep the plate, and the mobile phase is over here, which gradually descends in this direction to give you a separation of the compound. Then you have automated multiple development devices. This is how the development happens in gradient systems. We have gradient systems also, where you can choose many solvent, and they can be added in gradient. Then the development module again, where you can play with the stationary phase and the gas phase. So all this is present and controlled by the HPTLC software. Now this is the twin trap, which we already saw through. I'll not go again into it. And basically what we do is we get separation like this. As you can see, the components are being separated onto the plate, and from that we compare this with the sample. And we identify. So a direct comparison is being done by the eyes, by the instrument, and by the scanner to give you data. And that gradient can be used to separate such kind of peaks which are very closely associated, such as Jay and video. If you typically take an example and you want to separate them, so you use a gradient system for an example. I'm just stating their point, but you can separate such kind of components in which are very close to each other. Isomeric forms or enantiomers can be separated using this approach. And then finally you have the visualizer, which is taking the image. Now as I told you, the output comes after the development. You have the 366, that is the plate is dark, and you have the substances which are giving you illumination. This happens because a long UV light is being focused onto the sample. It is being reflected, and the fluorescence which you see is actually being recorded by the visualizer. Then you have the 254 lamp light, that is the shorter UV, in which your background is fluorescent, whereas your spots are shown darker in color, which is known as quenching. And you observe something which are UV active molecules like this. It can be ranging from 190 to 400. Anything under that will be shown up in this. And then you have the visible light, that is from eyes. What you see is known as the visible range, and this is in white light. So you can see anything from 400 to 800 nanometers, that is also being documented. And this is all taken in a very sophisticated way. You can take the RF values of this. RF is a representative front, which is the distance traveled by the sample divided by the distance traveled by the solute. and that will tell you the RF value. And so with the image, if you just click on any spot, you will get to know the RF value. So it is also calibrated what you're seeing on your image. So these are things that are taken care with a highly sophisticated instrumentation that is of German build and Swiss build cameras which are there, which is taking the photography. And this is how you see the data across different time points. I have done on day one, I have done on day two, I have done on day three, and then I have arranged it to see how much is the variation, where is the variation happening. I can see that. Now this is only possible in HPTLC and not in any other chromatographic technique. You can see what is happening across your samples over the time period, and that is visual. Like in any other technique, you don't know whether that unknown compound has come or whether it is still has to combine. You have to run, especially for there is a concept of related substances or degradants. You have to run it for 3 hours to see if there is any reminiscent degradation which is late eluting or early eluting. So these kind of problems are there, but in HPLC you don't have such kind of problems. Everything is immediate and right in front of you. You can see what has been separated onto the plate. So these are quite interesting, and this is how you utilize the data then at different time points. Now, when I was talking about the scanner, this is the data which you generate from the scanner, the chromatograms. Those bands which you see are converted into bands over here, and then from each band you can get a data like this, known as the spectra. You can scan it at different wavelengths from here to here, and you can see that at each wavelength it will give a certain kind of absorption, and that will collectively lead to a pattern known as the spectra pattern. Then you have the linearity. Using this data, the chromatograms, you can do a linearity. And also, if you are just viewing it for a qualitative purpose, you can see a 3D image of the entire system, and from that the image tells a lot of history out of itself. So you don't need to actually go and investigate, and if you are just okay with the visual confirmation, that also is possible. And basically, when you are doing the scanning, you are scanning at this different entire range of wavelength, and you can identify specific wavelengths what are there. So this is how principally how the chromatograms are generated. The incident light is falling onto the plate that is being captured by the photomultiplier tube, and you can see it as an output in the format of a chromatogram over here. And this is directly proportional to the quantity present onto the plate. But as every detector has a saturation level, because the plate also has a saturation level, you cannot go beyond a certain quantity, because that will lead to not these kind of sharper bands, but you will get humps like this, and that will not be able to, you will not be able to identify from it anything. So that is why it is important for you to optimize the volume, and optimization of volume is giving you a better response in your chromatogram. Then from the chromatogram, you get data like this, which can be overlaid, and you can see this fluorescent data. The spectra, again, you can see different spots have different spectras which can be overlaid and identified. This can be used for identification and can be used for purification. THC, which is a cannabinoid, and from cannabinoids, these are being analyzed. You see the peak of the standard and the sample, and this is how the chromatograms look. You can really go very low wavelength. This will not create any problem. You generate the chromatogram, the calibration curves, as you can see from the data which is being generated by the scanner, and can be used for quantification purpose of unknown. Then derivatization, an important step which I have already told you, to convert non-visible into visible, or to give you additional information whether it is an alkaloid and things like that, you can find out. So it gives you specificity, very ultra high sensitivity. You can go to really low volumes for identification, additional information as I told you earlier, and visual confirmation that yes, it is also present. It is the alkaloid which I am looking forward. So that kind of a physical presence is there. This is how it is done with the help of a derivatizer, which actually is a combination of a fume hood and a sprayer, where the dervatizing reagent is sprayed onto this food. It slowly settles down onto the plate, and the excess is removed with a flushing mechanism, and thereby you have a clean air which is being circulated into the lab without any fumes of the dervatizing reagent. And just 2 ml of reagent is required. You are saving again on reagents, which are very costly. So after dervatization, you can expect to see something like this. This is a most commonly used 15 class of compound screening, where alkaloids, anthracene, beta principles, coumarin, essential oils, these are actually based on herbal, but you can utilize it even on different fields like food and amino acids. You can use ninhydrin, and so many other applications are there of this technique of dervatization, and you can screen a very lot, huge lot of compounds with this technique of dervatization. Then you have HPLC MS interface, which is of which can be used for identification, confirmation, characterization, identity. And this is how it looks. Your plate is over here, the same plate which you saw in my hand. The pump is actually sending the mobile phase into this extraction solvent, into this TLC MS interface. From there, it is entering onto the plate, and from the plate is again going back and going into the MS. So this is a animation of how this happens. So the solvent is coming from here. It is diluting the sample, taking it, and sending into the mass to give you a mass spectra. Okay. There are many other advantages and hyphenations. I'll not go into this. You can go really a lot of samples can be done in a day, and without any complexities, which is not possible in LC-MS. Also, you have to tune a lot, but in this directly you can see what you want to extract, and that is how simple it is. You can extract them and collect it in vials also for doing further studies. So that is also a utility. This is an example of tadalafil, which is a banned drug in an Ayurvedic formulation, and that is being tested and checked. Then these are pigment compounds known as quinones, which have been isolated and from Tectona grandis. This is a joint publication where an LC-MS from Shimadzu company is being hyphenated to the TLC-MS, and the data is observed with the mass which is being seen over here at the bottom. And the separation of this is actually coming from the HPTLC. So this is how the TLC-MS interface is being utilized. There are other detectors also, alternative techniques, which is based on bioautography. This is of a bioluminizer, where you use Ali Vibrio fishery bacterial solution, which has a moderate or mild fluorescence, which is placed onto the plate. You simply dip this plate with this reagent, and the places where you see dark zone show that the bacteria is dead, whereas the zones where it is not dead, that means it is alive, telling you that it is non-toxic. So you can screen a lot of samples with the help for toxicity profiling in waters, beverages, and many other advantage applications. I have just listed a few over here. Toxicity on soil and things like that. Based on this, you can do more applications which can not only have bioluminescence, but normal bacteria can be used for antimicrobial screening, and this is an example of that. The same microbial, antimicrobial screening, you can also perform enzymatic analysis. This is antioxidant analysis to know whether it will have antioxidant. So antioxidant, if I tell you, you eat Chyawanprash for more immunity, and that directly is materializing from the antioxidant activity of Chyawanprash because of Aula. So that Aula has a very high antioxidant activity, and that you can check with such kind of BBPH reagents. Then you can also check for Alzheimer's activity. If the person can have any Alzheimer, that can be done with the Alzheimer enzyme specific analysis. And you can predict whether this will be working on an Alzheimer patient or whether it will show an activity onto it. And similarly for diabetes, you have these two enzymes which are responsible, and using these two, you can tell whether your drug will be potent anti-diabetic or not. So these bio-orthographic techniques become very useful, and again you don't require a separate set of instruments. The same HPTSA system can be used for doing your normal analysis or such bio orthography. Of course, you require a microbiological lab where the bacteria and all these things have to handle. But when you say the chromatographic part, which we are separating onto the plate, that can be done with the same set of instruments. You don't require anything special. And then finally, these are some of the tested bio orthography assays which have been done: toxicity, estrogenic, genotoxicity, antibiotic, diabetes, Alzheimer's, antioxidants, melanin, and herbicides. So these are some of the things I quickly pass in these because it is not required. Okay, so now what are the different activities I can perform? I can do is a qualitative estimation from this. I can simply check my sample and standard and see whether it is present or absent or things like that. I can do a quantitative estimation, that is, I can see how much quantity is present onto the plate. I can do a fingerprint analysis, that is, I can just want to compare. Maybe it's a very difficult, I have a jadi buti and I have got that same jadi buti from another person. I just want to compare it. So that I will use as a fingerprint analysis. I will run a fingerprint of both the compounds with the same conditions, same mobile phase, everything same. And I'll try to look in the differences and comment that whether it is the same jadi buti or the second one which I have taken is having some differences. So that is the kind of fingerprint analysis which I am talking about. Then you have micropreparative, where you apply a single band onto the plate and you want to isolate something like that. So as I showed you in the plate also, there is a single band. If you can just see my video, there is a single band at the bottom which we have applied in a very long band, and that you can use it for your micropreparative work, which you can separate it and isolate compounds. Then you can use it for identification by MS, that is, you can use MS as a detector to find out substances, and bioactivity studies. So many types of possibilities which are direct related. Now, not only in terms of herbal, but there are certain other applications in pharmaceutical, like cleaning, validation, stability, which is there. Those all things can also be taken care by this set of instruments, process monitoring. So many, there are very huge aspects and applications of HPTLC where you can use it. And before you start with a research topic, you can just Google a little bit on the topic which you want to utilize HPTLC, and definitely you will find some resourceful papers onto it which you can study and perform this technique easily for your research work. So as I was earlier stating, botanicals and you can use this fingerprint identification. Now, this is how a fingerprint looks like. You have separated your compounds, and this, then you are comparing with the based on RF color and intensity of the bands across the image. And you just check it visually whether they are present or not. That is there. Then you have, you compare different samples, piper nigrum, piper longum. You can see this is black pepper. This is pipli, if you know, and you have eaten sometime. This is also known as kebab chini or something. I am not sure about it. And then you have even the lavang, which is there. So like that, you have an entire range, and you are just comparing it across and to find out whether it is the same or differences. And from the differences, like here, you can see if it is a retrofractum, they'll give you this fluorescent green spots which are not there in other samples. Similarly, this has a yellow color spot which is very distinct to Piper cubeba, and we always name this in the scientific way, never in the common names which are there, and that is why I'm telling you and reading out these names. Also, this marker is selective, so like that you can see a holistic approach this marker, and like that you can compare and come to a conclusion whether it is what kind of a sample. So this is the whole gist of why we do the fingerprint analysis. There are many literatures available onto the internet, and you can just type in the names. There is an HPTSC association also, and apart from that, you have many books on pharma and non-pharma, like Clark and Stahl book, TLC by Stahl, Egon Stahl, and you will find a lot of answers to your queries. You also have this handbook of Tinley Chromatography by Joseph and Sharma, which can give you guidance to many of your analysis requirements. Now, when we talk of using this instrument for doing any performance of validation, now basically there are two things: method development and validation. If I come to validation, first thing is the difference between calibration and a validation. A validation is you do it for a method, whereas a calibration you do it for an instrument to see whether it is performing to your desired task. But a validation is done of a method to see that you are getting the same output from the same method. So that is the difference between these two. And when we talk about validation, there are certain guidelines that you have to follow and give the output according to that. Normally, we follow the ICS guidelines. There are different guidelines for validation of different nations, like European Union has different guidelines. US has different guidelines. But there are certain guidelines which are like universal all across, and one of them is the ICH guidelines, and they are being accepted all in all platforms. And we perform also with the validation based on this platform. And this are some of the details of how a validation costs. Now, I'm just talking about the analysis cost over here, and that is what I have reflected over here. I'm not talking about the cost of chemicals and the cost of expertise and electric and resources, all through that. And now when we talk about application fields, there are enormous fields of application. You can apply to each application field with whatever you are interested in. These are some of the examples to give you a gist of how this technique is being applied to different fields: pharmaceutical applications, thimepride tablets, fast identification of impurities. I'm just going through a little bit fast because we are in a certain time constraint, and we also have some slot for question answers. So I'll just go in through antibiotics, degradation profiling. Then this is combined dosage forms. Not only single but triple combinations can be also generated. These are your chromatograms, which you can see over here after the scanning data is done. And the cleaning validation is there, content uniformity is there, whether the mixing is proper, whether the tablet has 500 mg of paracetamol or it has lesser, that you can find out by content uniformity test. Impurities which are there when you are synthesizing or keeping it for very long time, it is getting degraded. What is happening, that you can study with the form of impurity studies. Botanical applications. Identification, as we saw earlier, quantification, again, identification, some synthetic compound being added to Ayurvedic, that is also possible, herbs, then steroids, stability, with four marker approach, the newest guidelines from the IPC, stating four markers have to be used for validating your formulation or your botanical extract. And then in food sciences, oil, you can understand the quality of the oil which is being used. Aflatoxins, which are very dangerous and they are toxic to human beings, that can be found out. Micropreparative can be done. Sugars can be determined, what sugars are there. And with this, we have almost actually quickly summarized a few of the popular examples. If you do a lot of research work and you do a very good research work, always, of course, this is applicable to postgraduate students and above. But definitely, if you do some novel and research work, there is an international symposium which happens every year. And if it is really good and selected, you may get a registration from our side being done for you. And you can present as Indian scientists a very lot into this international symposium. And they always have back prizes over the past few years. And these are some of the winners who have actually got the reward of excellent research work. This is about us. We have been always the technologists and not the traders to do about it. This is our WhatsApp number, hpdsc@anthem.in is our email ID, our WhatsApp number, our YouTube channel. And this, you can just write it down for your reference, for your queries in future. If you require this, you can write us to lab@anthem.in. and hptlc@ankrum.in. So this gives you a small understanding of what hptlc is. Now I'll take for a second and I'll just start a small video of explaining how the process of hptlc actually happens, and then we may start on the question answer session. So let me just switch over the screen. So let me show you a glimpse of how this HTTPLC happens.
Thank you.
this was a short understanding and overall concept of HPTLCs. Now I rest my presentation and a short live video explaining you how it happens, a virtual demo. And now we are open to question answers. So may I ask you to unmute your mic one by one and ask me the questions so that I can answer your questions and queries.
So, Dr. Sagar, there was volume in your video. So, whatever you were explaining, meanwhile, was not clear. But okay. Anyway, the video was self-explanatory, so that's fine.
That's good. Okay.
Students, now we have time to discuss. You are free to ask questions.
So I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
So is it possible for us to pick up a band of interest from the plate and analyze it further, or we whenever we have to analyze, we have to analyze it with the whole plate itself?
So you can pick up and you can isolate that spot in a vial, but be sure to have it evaporated dry, because in solvent form it has lesser stability. But it is possible to remove it onto the plate. If you wish to do a live sample, that is immediately from the plate, then obviously you require it onto the plate. But if you have some other offline analysis which you need to do, like IR or NMR studies, you can definitely isolate it with the help of the instrument and use it in the vial and use it for your later studies.
Okay, sir. And also one more question, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
So, when you showed this different slides also in slide number 95, different bands, they had a different colors in the same band level. Why is the color of certain bands in the same level different?
Yeah, just let me switch on this same slide and let me go to the slide so that. So, is this the slide you are talking about?
Yes, sir.
So, if you see, these are of different samples. On the top, you have seen that I have mentioned over there the different plant species, and I also highlighted them during my presentation. This is Piper nigrum, and this is the sample crude. How is it looked? That is, normally we name it as black pepper, then Piper longum. Over here, known as Pipli, is at the bottom. So these are all having different chemicals that are inside them. And each band is actually a chemical which is present and getting separated onto the plate. The differences are because the difference in the chemical structures, chemical nature of these plant material. And that is why you see this variation in the colors. Like in one plant, it will be showing you this kind of a color, whether the other plant will not show you any color at that same point. So this is basically because they are of different plants, and that is why they are having different colors. And this has been derivatized. The plate has been derivatized with a chemical so that it is being understand much more better with anisaldehyde sulfuric acid. So that is why you are getting this variation of your spots. I hope this answers your query.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir.
Yes.
Sir, what is the difference between HPTLC and sir, TLC, sir?
So, let me go into the slide, which will clearly help you to understand this difference. So in TLC, you normally do the practice of taking the spot, taking the plate, and you do it manually. Like If I want to do a TLC, I'll take a plate, I'll take a capillary, I'll load the sample over here, then dry it in the air, and then again go for the development manually. So this is very crude, as you saw in this my first slide. In that, I had shown clearly some differences between TLC and HPTLC. So TLC is a yeah. This is the slide I was looking on. This is basically that it is very much more flexible. There are different points which I have actually pointed out over here. It focuses on simplicity and low cost. In earlier times, what you used to do when at in the years of 1960s and all, you just had to test it. You were not interested in how much it is present or not. You just wanted to identify. And that is why they wanted something tabletop. So they used to take out one plate, spot it with capillary, develop and see, and that's it, finish. But with the coming generation and the coming years, what happened important is that you need to get that same results each and every time when you want to do that experiment. And that happened because the concept of reproducibility and utilize the separation pattern, which is there basically. If you are not getting the fullest separation of compounds, then it is not of any use if you even if you use the method. And secondly, as a method, you want to try the same method somebody else has done. And if you are not getting the same results, it will give you no confidence and you will not be able to use the method for your analysis. So that is why reproducibility and separation power was important in HPTLC. Highly standardized methodology is there. Each and every person does with the same standard methodology. A standard HPTLC method will document each and every step, right from application, development, saturation time, which plate has been used, how much microliter, everything it will document. Whereas this is very flexible and anybody can do it anyway. Parameters are well defined, as I showed you a glimpse later on also, that the application length, application band, how the plate should be looking, these are all very well defined. Validation of methods is very easily possible. Reliable results are obtained, whereas over here, rapid and preliminary results were expected, that it should be rapid. And even I saw, if I could see the spot, my job is over. But now you are relying on that because quantitatively you are estimating, and that is why reliability is very important. So that is there. Secondly, it is totally manual, so you have no control over the technique. But now this is with the help of software and totally cGMP compliant with the electronic documentation, which is very much important. Today, if I rest a case in my maybe into a court, and I want to say that this is my case, so he will ask you first, show me the proof. So in case of TLC, these proofs are very weak because you had done the plate, you had recorded it manually. So you can alter the images, you can write the different name, and you can tell them, okay, I have done this. But in case of 21st generation, where we are using electronic distribution of data, the data is recorded electronically, and you take a lovely printout of the entire analysis and see, this is my case, this is what I have done, everything is documented, and it will tell the judge, okay, no manipulation has been done, it was done in this way, okay, and now it is done. So it gives you a total confidence of what you have done, total recording, and that is known as this judge in the field of pharma and other fields, it is known as the auditors which are done, and they check whether the data is proper or not. That is possible with HPTLC. Standard format is used, it is sophisticated. It is not that whatever I do, I can do in HPTLC. It has involvement of sophistication, proper stepwise approach, and cost also wise, it is a slightly costlier because you are getting instrumentation. You cannot expect a bicycle and an auto rickshaw of the same price. So there will be a price difference because the utility is different and the way in these two work is different, and the comfort it gives you is also different. So that is how the basic differences of TLC and HPTLC.
Yes, yeah, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah. And sir, who person, sir, will operate this HPTLC equipment, sir? I mean, so, sir, any person having a specific skill are required, sir, for this operation, this HPTLC equipment?
Yeah, if you know the basic understanding
when
of
when are you using in the like pharmaceutical sector, sir?
Yeah, so if you know the using of HPTLC, you can very well use HPTLC at any platform, say it in pharma, in food, and with little bit of training on the software, because software is also important. If you don't know the software, you will not be able to utilize it. So with that training which we provide, you can use the instrument, and it is very simple. Many methodologies, many different aspects, it is used across different platforms: pharma, food, herbal, then forensic, cosmetics. There are n number of fields: bioremediation, biodegradation of toxic dyes. Everything is being tested on HPTLC, so it has really a very high value of and can be done at many places over here.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Any more questions?
Anything else?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I am Supnil from Maharashtra. Sir, yeah, what is the basic need of HPTLC and TLC in agriculture field, sir?
So basically, you require, I would say that you don't require TLC. What you require is HPTLC. The reason what I'll tell you, in agriculture, we have a large produce of, there are various aspects in agriculture, if you see, like the soil chemistry, the plant which is being grown in a particular area, the fruits, why the fruits are so big, and in certain places, the food quality, the taste, and everything is important. So when you are testing this with I can say that, okay, I like hapus mango, or I like the fiery mango, fiery variant of the mango. But technically, when I am a scientist, what I want to know is the difference between these. And there is where HPTLC comes into, and it tells you the chemical differences between these two. Because as a scientist, I cannot say, okay, this is sweet, this is sour, and this is a little bit of a different taste, more yellow. These things are okay when you are talking about qualitative aspects. But when I'm talking of specific terms, that I need to know what is the exact difference and how, why is this difference coming in. For that, I go into the chemistry perspective, and there is a utilization of HPTLC. If I know that hapus is more selling than fiery, why is it more selling? What are the components that is more appealing to the common people? And then I do a chemical study. I apply this onto the plate. I know that mangiferin is a marker compound which is there in the mango, and that is more in hapus and less in fiery, which is revolving around the flavor which it has, and that is why it is much more appreciable. So that is why this is a scientific approach of just showing one aspect. Secondly, there are many other aspects, like this plant is in the water but still it is not dying, whether the other plants, they are there in the water but it is dying. Why it is not dying? So I will go into, I will check the chemical nature. I will find out that there is some chemical which is synthesized by the plant which is antimicrobial or antifungal in nature, because of which the plant is still alive. So this is another aspect of in the field of agriculture. Then third aspect is soil chemistry. I want to know whether pesticides are there. Pesticides cannot be done, but definitely if antibiotic residues, like you are spraying with different reagents to plants for agriculture for more produce, more resistant to pests and other bugs, you are spraying them with different kinds of antibiotics, and so that they don't get this bacterial infection or fungal infection, that you can find out from HPTLC, it is known as the residue. So like that, then from the agriculture, if you go into the produce, like I am preparing tomato ketchup, so the tomato from the field is going into a process factory, then I'm preparing it. I see that when I prepare from this field, it is still remaining intact. When I prepare from that field, it is getting degraded. So what is the difference? I will apply the ketchup samples and I find out what is the shelf life of that agriculture produce. That I can say that 3 months without any refrigeration, this plant will be okay. After 3 months, it will get a lot of fungal activity. Why is that? Because this is the degradation happening. When I talk in terms of chemical, I can tell you this is decreasing in the plant, and that is why it is susceptible to more of fungal growth. So like that, there are different, a lot of applications in agriculture field, and it has been utilized in agriculture field, especially when you talk about the chemical nature of these, and chemically when you want to identify, HPTLC becomes one of the very important tools in our field of agriculture. Hope these examples have helped you to correlate how this technique can be used in the field of agriculture. Thank you.
Yeah, sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Guys, did you understand the whole technique and the applications, or you are not asking the question, so I am a bit confused.
Yes, ma'am, yes, sure.
I think, sir, they are undergraduate students, so they have, I don't know, one or two may have used this technique. Otherwise, they have only learned theoretical part, so they have not used this.
Definitely. So I can definitely understand that. And when I was also in my bachelor's, it gives us very difficult to understand until and unless we see some practicals, or we do it practically, or we think in this perspective. So I'll give you a lot of food for thought, and also shown you a example that is with the help of that demo, a video demo, which you can see, also access it from YouTube and get more knowledge of how this thing can be utilized. So this should give you a food for your thought, and it should definitely give rise to your questions in the coming time period. We are open. You can write us at lab@agrum.in, and I'll be glad to help you out with all your questions and queries. So with this note, I thank you for all your valuable time, and I hope you had an informative and very detailed session explaining the core concept of HPTLC and some applications. With this, I would like to hand over the session back to Meghna ma'am, and over to you, ma'am.
So thank you so much, sir. And when they come here, as you know, we have HPTLC instrument. So when they visit our lab, we'll arrange some hands-on training, and they have to obviously work on that instrument. So that time we would like to have your session or support live with that time, so they can understand.
Sure, definitely.
So thank you so much. I am really happy to see you again, and every time you support us. So it's really